I know you like to do the computer too.
Try again.
I think they're the worst. I've been all over the country, and I think the people that drive here have no conception, have no feeling about driving whatsoever.
I found over the years that there's an extraordinary number of older people who are vital, they're imaginative, they're alert, they're funny. They're exactly the kind of people I'd like to be.
Why is last-minute shopping or impulse shopping so dangerous?
Because it's very hectic. You don't have a chance to examine the merchandise. You're dealing with inexperienced salespersons. You are not getting a choice of merchandise because it's last-minute shopping.
Those stories on tonight's Montage. Hello, I'm Joe Abril. I'm going to mention a word now that may tell us how old you are. Computers. Now, if you've broken out in a cold sweat and your hands are clammy, you're probably over 25 years of age. If you're under, you already understand computers, you play with them. They're as much a part of your life today as pencil and pen was for most of us. But there's more to the story, and for that, here's Ed O'Dell.
Wake up, computer.
If you can't quite understand what little Joshua Frankel is saying, it is, wake up, computer, wake up. Have you ever seen a more perfect picture of the future? A two-year-old sitting in front of a machine that is predicted to alter the world in which we live.
I know you want to do the computer too.
Try again.
We are all caught up in the storm of change being created by the microcomputer. Many of us are lost and confused and maybe even afraid of the new world this machine might help to create. But some educators feel that tomorrow's adults can be introduced to the computer at a very tender age.
Okay. You got it all by yourself.
Computers have become a part of the educational process this year for the preschoolers in the Early Childhood Development Department of the Beth Shalom School in Hollywood. Here, children from 2 to 5 are introduced to the computer as another learning tool.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It is only a very small part of their whole school program and their day. We can't just sit a child at a computer when they come in the morning and leave them there for the day and say that we're giving them an education.
I do the hokey pokey and I turn myself around. That's what it's all about.
So that means they still must get a little hokey pokey, a little cut and paste, identifying colors, the hands-on experience that children need as tools to learn things like classification.
Okay.
That is, learning associations like what goes with what.
Do you think the dog could use the plate or the dish, the dog dish? Then would you put it by the dog?
Thank you.
That lesson is then reinforced by a fun tool, the microcomputer. Now, of course, two-year-olds can't spell or read very well, so what they do here is use the space bar on the computer keyboard to tell the machine when they think the arrow is pointing at the right answer.
What floats on the lake?
I see a lot of squares. That's a rectangle. That doesn't go here.
No, not a rectangle.
No. Wrong.
Well, the pessimists among us might envision maybe that you're training these computer hacks, these little people who are going to be sitting at their little screen, learning, yes, but avoiding the outside world, so to speak.
Well, that's our concern, too.
Shirley Cohen is director of the Beth Shalom School.
To sit in front of a computer and look at a flower does not take the place of a teacher or a parent looking at a flower with a child and smelling it and touching it and planting the seed.
Do we have this long space bar on a computer?
Yes.
Yes, we do. Do we have numbers on the computer?
Yes.
And do we have the letters on the computer?
Yes.
Do we have paper?
No.
No.
Does it concern you at such an early age, 2 and a half?
No, just another game to him. It's something else, another way to learn something that he's, you know, reinforcement of things he's doing in class.
There is no point in saying, I don't like computers, I won't accept them. They are here, and our children are going to be growing up with them in every aspect of their life.
I can't think of any psychological drawbacks. I think it offers the child an exciting way to learn, to increase their attention span, to find immediate satisfaction and reward with the knowledge that they're able to put into the machine and Used properly, it only has its advantages and not disadvantages.
There is one lesson to be learned if you are interested in buying an educational package for home. Don't buy software too difficult for your child. For instance, two-year-olds have limited language skills. Most available commercial software demands that the child be able to read and spell. For that reason, the teachers over at Beth Shalom had to create their own program.
Are you ready?
Yes.
The Beth Shalom School experiment with the computer points out two other standards for use of computers by preschoolers. One is interaction, the other is making sure that a computer is only a part of the child's program. The interaction between student-teacher, student-to-student, and parent-child must remain. And the computer, to be effective, must be only a part of the child's growing experience.
The worst drivers are probably downtown Boston, Boylston Street. Okay, the cab drivers in Boston. No courtesy at all.
Most people regard the drivers from their hometown as being the worst. And it seems that people in Dade County aren't any different. It's true, fighting rush hour at any time of the day is the last thing most of us want to do. But are Dade County drivers really that bad?
I think they're the worst. I've been all over the country, and I think the people that drive here have no conception, have no feeling about driving whatsoever.
According to State Farm insurance figures, Miami Beach and Miami are the two cities in Florida where you're most likely to get into a car accident. This dubious distinction is getting Dade drivers right where it hurts, in the pocketbook. For example, an adult who lives on Miami Beach and drives a late model four-door sedan will pay $418.16 for a six-month policy, while someone from Fort Lauderdale will only pay $283.82 for the same coverage. People who make a living working in traffic agree that Dade County's drivers are a real problem.
The worst drivers I've ever saw. All I do, I don't drive, I dodge. I drive for a living. I drive about around 200 miles a day, and I have to dodge all the time.
The numerous types of accidents that keep him busy also keep insurance companies happy and people like Highway Patrolman John Anderson on his toes.
Probably on the interstate systems are going to be a rear-end type collision where you have traffic stopped and the driver behind you fails to stop and runs into the rear end of you. On your city streets, I would say probably one of the most common causes of accidents there would probably be violation of right-of-way type accidents, either from a left turn or coming out of a private road or driveway.
The type of driver most likely to cause an accident? It's the drunk or doped-up driver. 50% of all deaths on the highway are alcohol or drug-related. Trying to arrest them before anything happens is nearly impossible. Only one in 2,000 is ever caught. Dade County Traffic Court Judge Harvey Baxter thinks he has a way to improve on that record.
Eliminate the right to refuse tests because people are refusing. They figure, oh, well, they can't get evidence against me, and it's a lot more difficult to convict. So the requirement is if you drive upon the highways and are drinking or under drugs, and when blood, breath, or urine is requested, you shall submit.
DUI is a big problem. But you're still wondering what's behind the everyday traffic problems all of us face here in Dade County.
We down here in Dade County are confronted with the staggering amount of traffic volume that we have, which you don't run into in your smaller counties. So that makes it more difficult on us working traffic. Your smaller counties, you don't have a rush hour traffic. It's not really even discussed or even heard of. Down here, obviously, you can see we have rush hour traffic almost 24 hours a day.
Flowing in this sea of cars, but not always smoothly, are the elderly drivers, tourists, and people from out of the country.
Now, what about elderly drivers? There was a recent
That is a problem.
Okay.
That is a serious problem. People just reach a point, and I don't know what that point is. Some people it might be 70, some people it might be 80, 90, and some people could probably drive well past 100. That would depend on the individual. I think probably the best thing would be once people pass the age of 65 or 70, have a retest at a frequent interval just to make sure that they're fine.
The elderly are not the only problem. Yes, it's tourist season and the snowbirds are here. This only adds more congestion to an already saturated road system. Many of the tourists are unfamiliar with the areas, so they slowly feel their way around our streets, often slowing up traffic and sometimes causing accidents. In fact, many of the drivers in Dade County aren't from the U.S. Just one trip to the License Bureau can give you a pretty good idea of how many foreigners drive our streets.
No, 202 no es apartamento, es una casa.
Ah, okay. ¿Nunca le han suspendido la licencia? ¿Tiene algún problema físico mental?
Slight little errors that they may make because of their unfamiliarity with local circumstance, but driving is pretty much the same the world over. People just don't think, they're in a big hurry, they do stupid things, and that's what causes accidents.
And then there are the rubberneckers.
People, for some reason, when they see flashing lights, are attracted to them. I don't know why. And they'll stop or almost come to a complete stop in the roadway and watch what's taking place around them rather than paying attention to their driving.
By now, you're probably convinced day drivers are the worst anywhere. But if you think it's bad here, just take a look at how we compared with other big U.S. cities. Day drivers are paying less for their insurance than drivers in L.A., New York, Chicago, and Detroit.
So Miami and Miami Beach are big cities with big city traffic problems. Roads that used to carry an easy flow of traffic are now packed with cars. When compared to other cities in Florida, drivers here didn't fare very well. But when you look at the total national picture, Dade County drivers aren't so bad after all.
Well, for those of us who have been in South Florida for a number of years, we know we used to talk about, or the others used to talk about, South Florida as being almost an elephant walk of only old people. Of course, now we understand we are the wave of the future because the American population is growing older. With me is Dr. Ken Dykewald, who's a PhD in psychology and is a gerontologist and expert on aging. I think we all know we're all getting older. What's the good news or new news about that?
As we learn more about the field and as we study the aging process, one of the things that we're beginning to realize is that there are many ways in which we can age more slowly than many people do. Although life expectancy has already jumped from 47 in 1900 to 74 today, there are many people in the field of medicine and gerontology who feel that life expectancy could be hiked up even further, perhaps as high as 90 or 100 by the turn of the century.
Well, I've heard that. Is that really a reasonable expectation?
Yeah, and the way I think it's helpful to look at it is to first realize that although more and more of us are living into our 70s and 80s, the human lifespan, the number of years to which the human body seems to have the capacity to go, is set somewhere between 120 and 140. So the idea is, why aren't we living out those years? Now, perhaps 100 years ago, the reasons we died young were cholera and typhoid and diphtheria and infectious diseases. But now when we look at what's going on around us, we realize that that which kills people way before their 100th or 120th birthday are no longer infectious diseases, but rather are diseases of lifestyle.
But I think it's more appropriate to talk about that with a psychologist, psychiatrist perhaps, than a medical doctor, because we've known those things for years now, but still people are not really heeding the message of good diet, nutrition, exercise, and so forth. So the question psychologically is, why are we not heeding those messages and doing what we already know will lead to a longer life?
I think the best way to answer is, number one, many people have begun to act on it. 5 or 10 years ago, the concepts of exercise or watching one's diet or keeping trim was something that was considered sort of fringe information. Right. It was more on the outskirts of medicine. Now, if you look across America, there is, in fact, a pretty extraordinary health revolution taking place. And I think it begins to suggest that large numbers of the population are beginning to take these issues seriously.
Well, now let's talk about you, because you're a young, youthful, handsome guy at 33. Do you look forward to getting old?
Well, I'll tell you, the more I've worked with the elderly, and I've been a fortunate member of the baby boom generation in that for the last 11 years of my life, I've worked directly with people over 60 and 70 and 80. The more I've worked with the elderly, the more I found that a lot of what people think about older people is wrong. When I first got into the field, I felt, oh, most older people are boring, or they're not imaginative, their lives are dull, you know, what fun can that be? But I found over the years that there's an extraordinary number of older people who are vital, They're imaginative, they're alert, they're funny. Yes. They're exactly the kind of people I'd like to be. And
as you like to be now, as a matter of fact.
Exactly.
Right?
Yeah. And the point of it is, as I've met people who I find attractive and exciting, my mind is almost opened up. When you meet a person who's 90 who lives a life just like you'd like to have now or then, it becomes easier to think of wanting to live to be 90 or 100.
Right. It's important for people to look forward to growing older.
Mm-hmm.
The old joke, the alternative is worse, of course. Ken Dykwell, thanks very much.
Thank you, Joe.
Now, I can't wait to see what commercial comes next. Constipation, liver spots on your skin, and false teeth glue. And I bet there won't be a young person in the bunch. Thanks, Ken.
Thank you, Joe.
I can't wait to get older. We'll be right back.
Do you find that you wait to the last minute to do most of your shopping?
In previous years, I have. Not this year. I'm trying to start a little bit earlier.
What we're doing is actually just going out and checking the prices now. So when we do our shopping, we'll know what we should spend.
Did you start your Christmas shopping this year?
I'm finished as far as I'm concerned. My wife does all of it. I give her the money, she spends it.
We all wish we were as organized as these shoppers, but for many, it's still too early to even start. This is what holiday shopping means to most of us, a binge that begins about a week before the big day. And even if we watch every penny the rest of the year, more generous impulses take over as the countdown to Christmas or Hanukkah officially begins. All of this good-natured spending also means it's the time of the year when the most complaints are received by consumer protection agencies about shopping rip-offs. What we found is, more often than not, it's the careless shopper, not the store or manufacturer, that's at fault. The best way to watch out for holiday rip-offs is to not let them happen.
Why is last-minute shopping or impulse shopping so dangerous?
Because it's very hectic. You don't have a chance to examine the merchandise. You're dealing with inexperienced salespersons. You are not getting a choice of merchandise because it's last-minute shopping. There are many reasons why.
There are many tips to help survive holiday shopping. This week, we did the shopping to show you what to include on your list. We looked at items that are in great demand at this time of year. That means the greatest number of complaints, too.
This is an emerald cut emerald with baguette diamonds and round cut brilliant diamonds set in 14 karat gold.
Jewelry is a popular but tricky gift item. Its value is hidden, even to the most discriminating shopper.
I came in, if I'm looking at an 18 karat gold chain or a diamond ring or earrings, can I take it out of the store and have it appraised?
You can have it appraised and return it within 30 days of the purchase date if you're not totally satisfied for whatever reason. This is a quartz movement. It has a limited warranty of 1 year.
Who exactly is responsible for labor and parts should this watch break?
We have an initial defective return policy of 10 days on our mechanical items, such as watches, all right? If not, then it is up to the individual to return it to the manufacturer's service station, so implied in the warranty that accompanies the watch.
Get that, shoppers? If it breaks after 10 days or 2 weeks, the store is not responsible for repairs. You should also check the warranties on major appliances, like refrigerators and washing machines, on video equipment, like televisions and recorders, and on electronic items, like personal computers.
This is a $600 chaise lounge that we're offering during November and December at $499, and we offer a bonus gift with it of the 3 snack tables.
Furniture is another hot holiday item. It has long-term use and value, and some shoppers order especially for holiday entertaining. The key here is to check the delivery date and installment payment plans if you don't have ready cash. Don't be surprised in January by signing on to an interest rate you didn't know was part of the deal.
We have our regular credit available to the customers, and we also have our holiday bonus plan. We stand behind everything that we sell.
So that means you have a return policy?
Absolutely. We have a return policy. Customer service is our main goal, and we will make the customer happy.
Many of us are still receiving beautiful Christmas catalogs like these in the mail. Well, don't fall for it. The Office of Consumer Affairs says it's far too late to order either by mail or telephone, unless, of course, your family and friends don't mind Christmas in January.
So even if you're standing in line at some cash register on December 24th, you can still save money and headaches by adding this checklist to your own. First, find out the refund policy before you buy. Get it in writing. Keep all your receipts and make returns promptly. And above all, don't forget to have a happy holiday.
Well, as you can see, it's not perhaps all Christmas cheer in this last month of 1983. If you have any problems with a store or a merchant, here's a couple of consumer numbers for you to call. In Dade County, 579-4222, and in Broward County, 765-5306, both consumer protection offices in each county. Now, 2 weeks ago, we had a rather remarkable story of a woman who lives on the streets of Miami with her shopping carts. Nancy Ross, you spent some time with Marilyn, we came to know on that story. What's happened to Marilyn since then?
Joe, I wish we knew. 2 weeks ago, you met Marilyn Minuta, and many of you were kind enough to want to help her. Marilyn, you'll remember, is a 58-year-old woman who's been living on the streets of Miami and Miami Beach. After our story aired, many of you called and wrote Montage, offering Marilyn places to live, clothing, money, food, even a job. With that good news, we went back to the streets to find Marilyn and all the places we'd seen her before. All we found were these empty spaces. Since our story aired, no one has seen Marilyn in the downtown area. Although both Miami and Miami Beach police are helping in our search, Marilyn cannot be officially listed as a missing person for a very simple reason. She's not missing from anywhere. You need a family or a home to be missing from, and Marilyn has neither. Now we're asking for your help again so we can help her. Starting Monday, anyone seeing Marilyn should contact Officer Sandy Wilbacher of the Miami Police Department at 579-6619 or call us at Montage, 579-1450.
Nancy, I think it's important to tell people we've already looked a lot of places for Marilyn this past couple of weeks.
That's right, Joe. We know she's not at the morgue, she's not at the jail, she's not at Jackson Hospital.
So, Marilyn, wherever you are, call us if you can, or if someone knows something about her, please let us know so at least we know she's well and safe and hopefully happy. That's Montage for this week. See you next week. I'm Joe Averill.